Easter. How is Easter? Did you have celebration, Easter celebrations? Have you read the speech I sent out with the e-news?
Yes.
It's actually the full speech from which I chose that Hindu passage today. That is about the Jesus Christ, the bride of God. That was the topic. And as we know, Easter is one of the biggest celebrations the world celebrates. All over the world, all Christians celebrate this day of Easter. And on this day, in order to prepare for this day, sometimes Christians observe, sometimes 40 days Lent, some Christians celebrate, observe 50 days Lent, some of them kind of really very strict, almost like fasting, kind of avoiding meat, some avoiding whatever the food they like, and then kind of take this time, reaching towards Easter, those time as a time for internal preparation, preparing to welcome Jesus Christ into their life, and also think about the suffering course Jesus was going through. So, this day, the celebration of this day, Easter, is not just a celebration day on just that day. And this Passion Week is actually the last whole week. It's many churches have a continuous adoration for week-long adoration. Sometimes like the whole Good Friday, then there's Holy Saturday, and they have this total fully day, almost the entire 24 hours of the day they stay in the church in veneration to Jesus's this suffering he went through. And also I feel this day, the very day, this Easter day, it was a day of hope for the disciples of Jesus. It wasn't just they come, oh, let's celebrate today. Not like that. It was, they hoped, they was, when the crucifixion was happening, they could not fully understand what is going on. Then on this third day, they felt, oh, our master is back. And that gives them great hope. And also that gives them that our master is a person of integrity. He said he will come back, and now he is here. And that's why Mary Magdalene was running around, oh, he is back, our master is back, let's go and welcome him. That's why everyone was very happy. And that gives them that, okay, we are some kind of comfort that we are on the right path. And that's why we celebrate this. That's why last 2000 years, Christians celebrate this day, the very day, this Easter, that on that same day, as Zerd mentioned, our two parents met with Jesus almost 80 years back. Jesus asked two parents to carry on his mission. And here, what is the great thing about Jesus? When you say Jesus had 30 years of his preparation time, then 3 years of public life, then at one point he had to choose the path of suffering and walk into the cross. The greatest thing about this path Jesus walked was Jesus knew when he was walking towards cross, he knew this is the only thing he can do that time. And of course, he could run away from that. He could say, no, I don't want this. And when he was praying in Garden of Gethsemane, on, I believe, probably Maundy Thursday, and then Jesus prayed to God, God, is this the only way I can go? Is it possible to take away this cross from me? I want to have a life. Is it possible?
But from God,
there was no answer. So he said, he understood that is the only way. Then with total conviction, my God, if that is the way, I'm here for you. I'm here to carry on the responsibility you have given to me. I'm not going to run away. I'm here. And that day, finally, I feel God felt comforted. God felt God was preparing. God was waiting for a person to totally understand his heart for past 4,000 years. And that day, again, Jesus walked into that cross. And the great thing is that when he was walking, thousands of people gathered around. And the crowd mocked him. The crowd was ridiculing him. I know most of you might have watched this great movies about the life of Jesus, the Passion of, what is it called?
Passion.
Yeah, Passion of Christ. And there were many other movies also. Some of them give big graphical things, sometimes very, very painful. But Jesus walked through that, maybe even more suffering. And when even the crowds were there, they were spitting on the face of Jesus. What are you doing? You told us you came here as the King of Jews. Are you the King of Jews? They spit on his face. But still, Jesus was praying for them. Jesus said, my God, they don't understand what they are doing. Forgive them. And while the soldiers were beating up him with the whips, he didn't curse them. And he took it as his responsibility. He didn't say any word that because of his failure, because of their failure, I'm doing it for them. Jesus didn't say that. Jesus was totally, I have to do this. Of course, they could not understand. That's okay. I have to do this. This is the mission I got from God. I'm not doing it for somebody else. I'm doing it for me. I'm doing it for God. And for God, I'm doing. This is my mission for God. If Jesus don't do, there is no one can do that. And I believe we are here on that foundation. If Jesus was in doing that mission, if Jesus was in going through that, we wouldn't be in a different position. And if Jesus ran away from that responsibility, true Father could not come on that foundation. And that is the beauty, and that is the amazing thing about Jesus. And that is why, that is the only reason for this past 2,000 years, thousands of people, millions of people, billions of people celebrate this day as a day of hope. As a day, God could feel comfort. As a day, the humanity could continue their hope for coming for the Messiah. They felt, okay, humanity as a whole. And God also felt, okay, now I can work on something. Now I can again continue what I'm doing, I was doing, so Messiah can come in person later. Later Messiah can fulfill the mission he is supposed to do. And that's what I feel the greatest thing about Jesus. He walked into that. He did not run away. He with total conviction, he walked on the suffering path. Directly walked onto the cross. And even when he was on the cross, he said, my God, forgive everyone. And I felt that conviction, exactly the same conviction in our true parents' life. True parents received this mission directly from Jesus. Jesus pleaded to true parents when our true father was very, very young, 16 years old. At that time, true father was praying, true father was very, very religiously devout person. He said, it is too hard for me. Father said, do you really want me to do this? And finally, Father said, okay, I will do if there is no one else. I'm there to do it for you, God. I'm there to do it for Jesus. What can I do for you? Tell me, how should I do this? And in the entire life of Jesus, so the entire life of two parents, we can see that conviction. Everything Father did, everything our two parents are doing right now, with that total conviction, with that amazing conviction they receive from Jesus, and which they receive from God. And that is what driving us. That is what leading us. I have some personal stories about that. One time in 2005, I'm sure you all know about that. In 2005, two father had a 100-city world tour. I believe in New Jersey. I think in Memorial Father visited as part of that. As part of that, in India, Father was, two parents were planning to visit. And it was supposed to be November 23rd, 2005. And that time, I was national, we were the national leaders of India. And we were preparing that for several months. And we had, our church in India was not like this. And we had like a congregation of probably, I think only two or three blessed couples. Then three or four Japanese missionaries, one Western couple, and we could not handle that by ourselves. Then we had some American missionaries came. Actually, that's the time, my first time I met Roshan. And then many other missionaries from all around the world, and many early Indians who joined the church in other countries also came. And so we were, they were there already, and we were preparing for several months. And but during that preparation time, on I believe it is October 29th of same year 2005, we had a big terrorist attack in New Delhi. It was very near to our church center. In fact, it was in four different places, and all these places were very crowd choking areas. And one area very close to our church was our members were shopping there right before, maybe almost half an hour before that thing happened. And immediately after I heard about that, I remember I'm calling all of our members who were, some of them were fundraising, some of them, I know this particular place, they were there. And lucky enough, they were all safe. And again, we were preparing. But few days afterwards, we received a memo from World Mission Department saying that India might be, Indian program may get cancelled. Because many, many international programs planned for India in New Delhi and also many other cities of India got cancelled. We had some of the big international sports programs were there and that got cancelled. And but again, after a few days, we received, no, we will continue with our current plan. And I believe that's because Father promised to heaven. And Father made this with cities and wherever Father has to visit, with as a promise to heaven, with deep prayer, with deep conviction, two parents finalized where they are going to visit. And then they could not change that. Even if it's in the hell, even if it is bombing happening the same day, they could not change that. Interestingly, we were preparing for another service project also, which is supposed to happen after a few months. And they cancelled that because they said India is not safe enough to hold this service project, and which was supposed to happen actually several months after this program. But two parents did not cancel. For two parents, safety wasn't the priority. For them, they didn't care about their safety. They did not worry about how to save their life. They worried about how can they fulfill their responsibility. How can I fulfill my responsibility to God? How can I fulfill my responsibility to all the human beings? For the entire population. How can I fulfill my responsibility? That's what Father's vision, that's what Father's mind, That's the, exactly the very thing Trumada is continuing. Just thinking about mission they receive from God. And again, last 2 weeks before when we visited Hawaii, and we went to a small house in Hawaii, which I had two parents bought them. That was the first house bought in Hawaii. And before, two parents went to North Korea. Two parents were praying in that home. And then they did a ceremony with Hyojinmi. And they prayed almost like anointing him as the next person. And father said, we might not come back. Most probably we will not come back from North Korea. And father asked Hyojinmi, if we don't come back, please continue the mission we are doing. And father was almost certain that they won't be able to come back. But it was a condition father had to do to restore the worst place on this earth. The worst place where communism is controlling everything. And father went there to restore that place, even by sacrificing his own life. Even with the total conviction that I may not come back, but still I have to go there. Without me being there, I can't restore that. And that is what Jesus did. And that is what true parents doing. And I know most of you witnessed to the time father went to Danbury prison, isn't it? How many of you were here? Maybe very few were not here. And almost all of you were here. And actually that incident, father could have very easily avoided, isn't it?
Yes.
For going to prison was not a thing. It was like, actually what was the question other people asked father, like the prosecutors asked, and some other legal people asked father, can you leave this country? We don't want to put you into jail. We just leave this country, isn't it? I heard. Am I right?
Yes.
Yeah, that was their goal. Their goal wasn't to put father into this jail. They wanted father to leave this country. They wanted father to run away from his responsibility. And they said, oh, don't worry, Reverend Moon. We will leave you. Don't worry. If you don't, we will not put you into prison. But you can go back to your country. You can have a good life there. Please go back. And that's what actually Jesus had to went through his life. Satan, when Satan come to, in the very beginning of his public life, when Satan came, Satan said, why do you want to go through all this kind of life? Why do you want to go through a suffering kind of life? I give you all world. I have everything. I give you everything. When Jesus was facing three temptations, Jesus Satan told him, take all this. Whatever, I own everything. Take everything. Why do you worry about all these things? And same like this, people came to father. Leave this. Don't worry about this. Why do you go to jail? Leave this. Just go back to your country. Have a good life there. Don't worry about this country. This is already messed up. Don't worry. Just go back. Just go back. And that was kind of comfortably saying, don't worry about that. Leave your responsibility. Then we can do whatever we want. But what did father choose? What was the thing father said when he was going there? Father said, I'm here to fulfill the mission I received from God. I'm not here to run away from my responsibility. I'm here to restore the entire world. And even if I go to jail, I don't care about that. Even if I don't come back from jail, I don't worry about that. I watched one time a video about, maybe many of you were there, father was speaking to all the American members while he was leaving to the prison. And that was kind of so touching video, where father was almost like speaking in a way he feels that he may not come back from that prison. And I certainly believe that was totally father believed that. And those things, this kind of conviction from the Messiah, that
is the real messianic course. And Jesus did that for us. Father did that for us. And now we are here on that foundation. And I believe many of you also experienced that in some your life, some point of your life, when you were going through, when you chose this path, many people ridiculed him. Many people feel like, what are you doing? And it is so hard. It was so hard to, maybe some of you, I asked many of you already, probably, I don't know, here, I always ask many of our elder members that, how did you join in early 70s? And some of you joined in 60s. How could you join? Because that time, there was no foundation like this. There was not a church like this for us. And still you ought to choose. And because I believe you understood what Father wanted to create. And what was the mission of Jesus? What was the mission of the Messiah? And that's why you ought. Some of you left your career. Some of you left Ivy League universities. Then chose to be with Messiah. As a responsibility and pledge to Messiah that I'm with you. I'm with you to help restoring the world. I'm here to create the world which you are telling us. And that's where we are here. And again, I feel in this time, now our true mother again asks us to, reminding us, why do we join in this organization? Why do we join with the Unification Movement? Why do we join with Unification Church? And that is what always our two parents reminding us. When we think back, same thing we are doing now, isn't it? We feel like we are doing same thing. And because the reason we are doing same thing is that we have to restore the whole world. And we have to bring everyone back to God. Here, yesterday, actually the first time in my work here, I spoke to Go Program, Go Kids. They, actually the topic I was asking, what is the difference between our church and other churches? And one of the things I said, we have Messiah with us. Messiah is living with us. And they are directly guiding us, directly telling us. Almost like in Jesus' time, Jesus could tell Peter what to do. Jesus tell Paul, Paul was in there, Jesus' time. And other disciples, Matthew, Mark, everyone, Jesus directly told what they should do. Sometimes Jesus asked them, oh Peter, you still don't understand me? What are you doing? Something like that. Maybe sometimes true parents tell us such kind of things. True fathers called us sometimes, you don't understand anything, isn't it? Yeah. We experienced that. We happily received that. We were happy to receive that scolding. And even from True Mother, we are so happy to receive that. And they are again and again telling our responsibility. Our responsibility is actually no difference from what Messiah was doing. In a much lower level, I believe. Smaller level. But it is the same thing. We all are supposed to come back to God. We all are children of God. We came back and our mission is to bring everyone back to that sonship and daughtership of God. And that is what we are doing. On this Sunday morning, on this Easter day, I want all of us to really, really, again, think about that responsibility we receive from God. We receive from Jesus. We receive by our true parents. We receive from our true parents. We promise to them that we will help you to restore the world. And we are here to restore the world. And sometimes I feel we all come from all around the world. I don't know exactly how many countries we are representing. And maybe no other churches in the whole world may have like in America. We have people from all around the world. Our church is filled with people from all over the world. And here, we are continuing. continuing that mission of Jesus, mission of the true parents, what they were doing when they were going towards the cross. What the amazing thing they were doing is that they were not thinking about other people's responsibility. They were just focusing on what is my responsibility. Jesus thought, what am I supposed to do? What is my responsibility now? I agree, I understand, no one could understand my mission. Then should I blame them? Or should I run away from them? Should I run away from this responsibility and lead a normal life? Should I do that? And Jesus walked not to run away. Jesus totally gave up to everyone. I'm here. You can do whatever you want. Kill me, blame me, spit on my face. Still, I'm here. You can do whatever you want to do with me. And Jesus totally opened his. There is nothing to protect him. Totally, Jesus opened his body, and even his body physically when people assaulted him. I believe that emotional assault was much, much greater than physical assault he has to go through. And Jesus led everyone to do that. And Satan was, when we see the Passion of Christ movie, we can see like a tiny creature, like that was in Passion of Christ, that was other movie, Kasanta Saki's movie, what was that called? Yeah, Last Temptation, like one creature laughing when Jesus is going through the pain. And that, I believe that happened when Jesus was emotionally being attacked and being attacked physically. Satan was laughing. But I believe more than that, God was, even though with painful heart, God was feeling comforted. Even though my son is being assaulted, he is restoring the world. And that's what happened when true parents' life, when true parents were attacked by the media, true parents were attacked, misunderstood by the whole world, they were restoring. They were restoring the heart of God. They were restoring everything for God and everything for human beings. And here, for us also, when you were going through your life, when you are going through your life now also, you are going through that. And let us really totally, without worrying that, with total conviction, let us walk through this. Let us go through this. And many times, many of you may get persecuted by people, by many people. But take it as a restoration. And I believe it is the restoration. Sometimes the restoration of relationships that happens maybe even within our families. And even I believe many times when you even in your workplace, sometimes as part of a small church, part of a new church, other people can't understand what you are doing. And I had that many times so difficult to even tell people and explain people why you are here. When I joined the church, I had that difficulty. And people could not understand why I leave my big good church and going to another place. And they could not, they didn't even feel it as a church. They feel, I become kind of some kind of organization he joined. He doesn't go to church every Sunday. And then even my friends, my classmates started asking me, what are you doing? And I tried to explain them, but they don't fully understand. And I don't know how to explain more than that. And one time, I had an incident. He was fundraising with the ball pens. And I get into an office. And I called that person who was, actually when I get into that office, he was kind of piling up something in the wardrobe, and I could not see who is that. And then I called him, excuse me sir, holding his friends in my hand and he turned around and
your buddy.
My buddy in my class. And he was kind of almost like a laughing friend. What are you doing? You are here like this? And I was kind of popular in my school because I used to be part of basketball team and I was active in politics and I was part of college student union. So they used to look me up. Then they said, you are like this? Selling pens? What are you doing? Then, actually, that helped me. I couldn't hide anything afterwards. Actually, yeah, this is what I'm doing. I'm doing it for, I'm fundraising for my organization that has a church, that has this and that, many, many things. And after that, for a while, they used to tease me, but they stopped that. And that's what I feel like, because somehow, even though I did not personally take away that hidden face of me, God took out that. And God took out that veil I had in front of me. And then, when that clarity came, I feel like I'm liberated. I feel like I don't have anything to hide. Why do I have to worry now? My closest friend know about this. Who should I cover anything? Even my priest, when I go back to my village, I still meet with my priest and he's not there anymore. In our tradition of Catholic Church, they change every 3 years, the assistant priest has to be changed. Every fifth year, chief priest has to be transferred. But I still go and meet with the people we used to work together. And with them also, I tell this is what I'm doing. And they have no problem when I tell them straightly, this is what I'm doing. And I feel that's what Jesus is telling us. That is the greatest story Jesus telling us on why going through that Passion Week. Do not hide anything. Be who you are. Show who you are. Once you have, no one can accuse. People may accuse, but that will, God will glorify you. Because Jesus went through that kind of life, God glorified him. Satan could not accuse him anymore. Satan could not accuse God anymore. If God could have put him from the very beginning without going through, Satan could say, you know, he is like that. You put him into leadership and that's why he is enjoying that. Let him suffer. Let me see what he will do. And that's what exactly Jesus, true parents did. And that was what we were going through. And that is what we are going through every day in our life. And be proud of that. By doing that, we are actually nullifying the accusation from Satan. From any people who can accuse you, they will shut up that. They have to. And that's why, brothers and sisters, on this Easter morning, I want to thank all of you who were making this amazing foundation for God. Amazing foundation for God and true parents. And for Jesus. And let us thank Jesus. Let us thank our true parents who received the mission from Jesus and carry it on. Let us really, really break down the walls we have still. And truly let us come together. And even as we come from all around the world, we may still have the baggages of the culture we have. Let us break down that. Let us totally unite as a one unified culture within ourselves so that we can truly embrace everyone. I'm no longer just an Indian person. You are no longer as just a Japanese person. No longer an American person. We are the children of God. We are the children of God who are restored children of God. Let us truly enjoy that. Sometimes the wall within us is like stopping us to talk to our friend, our brother in our church. Let us break down that. Let us truly, totally be open to each other so that we can totally become a unified, create that unified culture, create that heavenly kingdom. God was waiting for thousands of years, and then it totally, the whole world can see that what we were doing. The whole world, without any accusation, people join with us. People want to celebrate the presence of God, and that is the thing, very thing missing from the world. The only that people want to enjoy the feeling of God, but many times they can't have. We can't have because we have that barriers stopping us to enjoy a relationship with our brother, our sister, our husband, our wife, our children. Every relationship is be totally open. We don't have anything to hide. We are who we are. Then God can work in us. God can truly work in our community, work in our church. God can govern, restore the whole world. So on this Easter day, Easter morning, just want to remind you all these things, and let us really thank our true parents and our Jesus, and thank our heavenly parents for giving us this opportunity to come together, centered on God. Every Sunday morning, we come together here. I totally enjoy that, and because of the presence of you, because of the presence of sons and daughters of God, the sons and daughters of our heavenly parents, let us really enjoy that. Let us really passionately enjoy that. We are beyond that. We are beyond that accusations. We are here to enjoy the presence of God. Enjoy the presence of Jesus with us. Enjoy the presence of true parents with us. And enjoy the presence of all of us together. Thank you so much for coming on this Sunday morning. Have a blessed week and wonderful Easter too. Isn't it?
Yeah.
Happy Easter!
Happy Easter.
Okay.